But in a situation where you find that they look like the same,
not necessarily tribal or regional.
All right, welcome back. This is Daybreak on Trust TV. Time for us to take a look at the dailies on Daybreak, and we have papers lined up for you. Beginning with the Daily Trust newspaper this morning. The lead story here says, old naira notes legal tender again. That's according to the Central Bank of Nigeria. It has the writers that says, you have no reason not to comply with Supreme Court judgment, says Buhari. Another writer, banks struggle to meet customers' needs. Pensioners decry naira scarcity, say we are in pain. It's good news. Traders, POS operators, you'll find all the details of that story on page 19. Now, above the lead story, we have fire destroys 100 shops, stores in Kano Singa Market. And that's on page 6. National Assembly leadership, I've not endorsed anyone, says President-elect on page 10. We have nothing to hide, INEC chair tells Obi's lawyers on page 10. And now below the lead story, Tinubu's election rejection of religious hatred, sectarian politics. That's according to the presidency on page 27. Nigerians to pay 1,000 naira fee for NIN integration verification, also on page 27. ISDB, LLF donate 100 million naira storage facility to milk marketers in Kano. Now, the pictorial there shows you a trader's peak remaining of their wares after fire incident at Popular Singa Market in Kano yesterday. Below that pictorial, you'd find also violence. Seven states to watch ahead of governorship polls. Why we are afraid, residents. How to avert crisis, experts, CEOs. Now, to get more details about that story, you'll find that on page 4 on Daily Trust newspaper. These are the main stories on the paper today. We're also not forgetting that we still have 11 schoolgirls of FGC burning Yauri, 637 days after captivity. One student of Bethel Baptist High School, Kujama, 613 days after captivity. It seems no one is saying anything about this ones, but we urge for their release. Well, these are the main stories on the Daily Trust newspaper this morning.
All right, now let's take a look at the Punch newspaper. It has a list there still on the Naira issue. MFLA finally bows to pressure, says old Naira notes legal tender. The first rider, CBN directs banks to accept, disburse old 1,000 Naira, 500 Naira, 200 Naira and redesign bank notes. And the second rider, disobeying court order undermines the rule of law, constitution, democracy. This is coming from the NBA president. And the third rider, AGF CBN governor, don't need Buhari's directive to obey Supreme Court, according to the presidency. Beneath that, we have a pictorial of a meeting that held yesterday between the leadership of the APC and the members-elect. And under that, we have Tinubu has no preferred candidates for National Assembly leadership, Shatima. And just by the masthead, we have, I wasn't part of search for kidney donor, Ekweremadu's wife. And above the masthead, federal government probes theft in $1.1 billion oil well. We also have Nigerians to pay 1,000 naira NIN fee for passports. Federal government shuts Lagos airport runway, diverts international flights. These are the major stories on the Punch newspaper for today.
All right, now on the Guardian newspaper, the lead story there talks about the Naira redesign policy. It says Buhari absolves self as CBN finally obeys Supreme Court order. CBN, that's the writers now, CBN has no reason not to obey Supreme Court on Naira redesign policy. CBN releases cash to banks as rationing intensifies. Obey Supreme Court judgment, NBA urges federal government and CBN. Middle Belt Forum, Kogi urge action on Supreme Court ruling. Now, above the lead story, Africa's energy crisis raises fresh health environmental concerns. 10th National Assembly leadership, I have no preferred candidate, says Tinubu. CBN debunks report of MFLA plotting against Tinubu. Borno Yobe risk acute food shortage, World Bank alerts. You have Rhodes Vivor remains LP candidate, party's legal team clarifies. Election materials, we have nothing to hide, INEC chair tells LP legal team. These are the main stories on The Guardian this morning.
Over now to the Nation newspaper. It also has a lead story that has to do with the Naira. CBN okays 1,000 Naira, 500 Naira old notes after Buhari's rebuke. The first writer, this is from the president. I never asked Emefiele Malami to flout Supreme Court judgment. And there's a quote here. The CBN has no reason not to comply with court orders on the excuse of waiting for directives from the president. And then beneath that, we have February 25th poll, Nigeria's best ever, says president. And then just beneath that, from the NBA, election okayed by 92% of Nigerians. We also have APC to decide zoning of National Assembly offices after elections. And just above the masthead, we have ADP, NNPP, ZLP, six others endorse Sanwo-Olu. Then we also have Lagos Airport runway shut for repairs. Apico reserves judgment in Adeleke suit. Beneath that, high energy cost affecting manufacturing, says man. These are the stories on the Nation newspaper for today.
All right. Now, on the leadership newspaper, the lead story is somewhat similar to all that we've seen in other papers. As it talks about a scarcity of Naira bites harder. PMB disowns Emefiele Malami over defiance of Supreme Court. You have the writer says he's not responsible for plight of Nigerians. Old Naira notes remain legal tender, CBN governor. Labour gives FG 7 days to end Naira and fill scarcity. Now, other stories above the lead story. I have no anointed candidate for Senate president. That's according to the Tinubu talking about the principal officers of the National Assembly. Now, Lagos runways repair. Airlines may incur additional cost flight delays. You also have Yobe Auditor General jailed 5 years for fraud. We have 10 days left to file petitions against the tribunal, says Labour Party. So these are the main stories. We have other stories beside the pictorial there. 2023 presidential poll better than past elections, says President Xi. Alleged anti-Tinubu plot. We are nationalistic, apolitical, says Army. Appeal court reserves judgment in Osun Guba case. So these are the main stories on the leadership newspaper this morning.
Now let's take a look at the This Day newspaper. The This Day newspaper has a lead story that is similar to all the others. So I'll just take the two that are not prominent on the other newspapers. There's a story here just beneath the masthead that says, from Falana, Nigeria's political class don't want democracy to survive. This is on page 12 of the newspaper. And above the masthead, we have Obi replies church leaders, elder statesman, says Tinubu not God's will in presidential poll. These are the major stories, aside the ones that other newspapers have on the This Day for today.
All right, so time for us to take a look at perspectives to this. More insight on some of these stories. We have Dr. Theophilus Abba, the director of the Daily Trust Foundation, with us in the studio. Thank you so much for joining
thank you.
Us this morning.
Good morning.
Yeah. Well, the cash policy, the cash redesign policy is everywhere on the papers this morning, rightfully so, given the recent developments as far as that is concerned. We've seen that a Supreme Court judgment that was issued, beg your pardon, more than 10 days ago, it's now beginning to take effect in the sense that we have The CBN released a statement. We have the presidency also released a statement in a similar vein. So, what do you make of all this now at this point?
Okay, I think it's a welcome development that the CBN has instructed banks to accept whatever you call the old 200, 500, or 1,000 naira naira notes and legal tenders. But you see, it talks a whole lot about the independence of the CBN. Now, when the fourth deadline for the use of the new naira note was given, you know, that was the deadline to stop acceptance of the old naira notes. You know, everybody was saying, oh, it was too short, the time was not enough. We remember that the CBN governor went to Daura, he met with the president, and the president said, okay, extend. Then he extended. Then the Supreme Court also said, look, 10 governors have, sued the CBN, the federal government on this matter, and they want you to remain, the statu quo should remain. That means that whatever you call the old naira note should be in use until it was determined. The CBN did not act on it. The CBN waited for the president to give a national broadcast where the president said, okay, only the 200 naira note to be used until sometime April 25th. So it follows then that we expected, the president, you know, to instruct the CBN, you know, on what to do about the Supreme Court judgment. We say that these naira notes are still legal tenders. If you look at the sequence, you know, it's very clear that Emefiele had always referenced the president. I remember when the issue of the new naira notes were coming up, there was, disagreement. Clearly, the finance minister who said, look, this will affect the economy. And I remember the CBN, governor, holding a press conference. And the only statement I heard from him, because it was a clip that I saw on TV, was that I have the backing of the President Muhammadu Buhari, or the President of the Federal Republic of Nigeria, Muhammadu Buhari, to do this policy. You understand? So, for the president to now come and say, Emefiele did not need express instructions from him before obeying
this. Was that he didn't, part of the statement was that the president did not ask anyone not to obey Supreme Court.
Yes, order. But if you look at the precedents, you know, even obeying court instructions previously, Emefiele had to wait for the president. To extend the date, even when it was clear to Emefiele that there was not enough new naira notes, you know, to go around, and that people were appealing for the old naira note to be used, he had to go to Daura to tell the president, what do I do? The president asked, okay, extend it, you know, by some weeks. You understand? So if he had always gone to the president, you know, to take instructions, it follows that he was expecting the president to instruct him, say, look, obey
the Supreme Court order. He always went to the president to get all of these instructions. Based on the CBN Act, was that normal? Is that what should have been done?
But that is the issue. You know, the CBN is not demonstrating the kind of independence, you know, that we expected. Let me give you an example. Just at the beginning of, at the weekend or last week, the Silicon Valley Bank, you know, ran into a crisis. And the Secretary of the Treasury came out plainly to say, look, we are not going to bail out this bank. But if you have a deposit in this bank, you are entitled to about $250,000, you know. But to expect the Treasury, that is the equivalent of the CBN in the United States, to say we're going to bail out this bank, we are not going to do it. It wasn't the president, Biden.
But as far as monetary policy is concerned, such as the cash redesign, you know, is concerned, some people have made the argument that, yes, the CBN governor cannot act all by himself. It has to be in consonance with the president as far as taking decision on cash redesign is concerned.
Yes, it's true that the CBN is independent, but that doesn't mean that it will act in a manner as not to involve the presidency. But even if it does too, it must demonstrate that, look, we took the decision, we know why we took the decision.
Well, you understand? Do remember the broadcast, the early morning broadcast by the president. He said, I authorized. Uh-huh. That was the language that he used, which meant that even though the CBN appears to be independent, the president gave
still gives instructions to the CBN. You know, so we expect that the CBN will do whatever is appropriate, you know, to ensure that the economy, to ensure that the financial sector does not suffer.
So this statement by the presidency does it then hold water to say that the president didn't ask anyone not to obey court order? The broadcast, the presidential broadcast, after the Supreme Court order, didn't mention anything about the Supreme Court, yet it said that only the old 200 naira notes will be recirculated.
Yes.
It didn't talk about the 500 naira notes. It didn't talk about the 1,000 naira.
Yes.
So going by that, you know, does it now hold water to say the president didn't ask MFLA Attorney General not to obey court order?
Of course. Yeah, I mean, it doesn't hold water. I think it's a face-saving statement because, I mean, Nigerians have come hard on the presidency over this matter. Because even before, you know, the president traveled to Qatar to attend a conference. You know, before then, I think it was shortly before then that the Supreme Court made the pronouncement. And everybody was surprised. Why would you be silent? Even when the Supreme Court has made this statement, you didn't say anything. You just get quiet. You came back. You went to Daura. You know, we didn't hear anything. People were suffering. A journalist even died trekking to work. You know, but I'm thinking that the CBN can repair what has been damaged by bringing out whatever it has confiscated from Nigerians. The 500 naira note, the 1,000 naira note that a CBN has, I mean, collected from us, want the CBN to give this money to banks so that they can dispense.
But I would like to know though. You know, yesterday morning, the early hours of the day, the former governor of the CBN, who is now governor of Anambra State, said that he spoke with the current governor of the CBN and that banks were going to start issuing the old money. But the CBN itself did not issue a statement. Their statement only came after the presidential spokesman's statement.
I think immediately after, Soludo made the statement on his Facebook.
Yes, now, on his verified handle.
Yes.
But what I'm trying to say is that the CBN did not issue an independent statement on this issue until the presidential spokesman said that the president didn't ask anyone not to obey. Now, the question a lot of people are asking is that, wasn't it possible for the CBN governor to have asserted himself, seeing that the CBN is independent?
He ought to. Because that is what the CBN's independence means. You know, if you have noticed that, look, this thing is affecting the economy, this thing is affecting the system, a lot of things are grounded. Being the CBN governor, you are supposed to make moves. And then we expect that you know better than the president. If you make the move, you can, Mr. President, this is what we have to do because of ABCD. Then you go ahead and do it. But you cannot wait for, Buhari, who is enjoying himself somewhere, to say, okay, do this or don't do that. And when Buhari say, the president said we did not instruct them not to obey Supreme Court judgment, of course, I don't think that is the right thing to do. You know, Buhari cannot now say, okay, don't obey Supreme Court judgment. You shouldn't be saying that. But then if we discover that over this period of time when this crisis began, you kept giving them instruction, then it follows that we said that you did not give them that instruction to obey the Supreme Court. But I'm thinking that the CBN should make this cash available. A lot of things have happened. A lot of businesses have gone under. You know, all the agencies related to the finance sector, they keep complaining that, look, this thing is causing problem. The manufacturers of Nigeria complain. The small-scale businesses, they also have been complaining. Now you can't even buy anything except you have cash. I mean, people don't have,
ATM.
And they don't have bank accounts. You know, they don't have bank accounts. And now if you want to transfer money to them and you are using a POS machine, you pay. You pay for to the POS machine who will take the money from your ATM card. And then you pay for them to transfer the money to the other person's account. And then if you need cash, then you have to buy your own money. You know, so it's not a system It's a very ridiculous system. And there's no way anybody will turn a blind eye to the fact that Nigerians are suffering. Nigerians are suffering, businesses are suffering.
Can we really even quantify the suffering or the cost of this decision on Nigerians and the economy generally? We've had a lot of stories about how people sometimes, you are going to make withdrawals and someone is saying, well, you're going to pay 4,000 naira to get 10,000. So that's like taking almost 50% of whatever it is you want to, you know, withdraw and the rest of it. So can we really quantify this?
Well, I think I don't know if any agency of government or
I saw a report yesterday that said that Nigeria lost 2 trillion. Uh-huh. But then that's the one that maybe they were able to capture. Maybe they have not even captured the ones that happen in rural areas and, you know, a couple of
places. They won't be able to capture those ones, or instead they approximate. The fact is that, I mean, it's possible, you know, if they contact the Manufacturing Association of Nigeria, they contact even banks. For instance, if banks used to earn an average of maybe 20 million in a day from transactions, you know, and now they earn only 5 million, or if businesses used to, make average sales of, let's say, 5 million, and they now make 2 million. You know, they can come together and say, this is the amount of money that may have been and lost. But my fear is that, in the first quarter of 2023, two things will happen. Tax collections will go down because businesses are not operating at full capacity. So the FIRS may not be able to meet its target. That is number one. Then we'll likely see a measure of, a reduction in production. You know, I'm going to see, the economy would contrive, you know, a little bit because of this situation.
So when you look at it on a holistic basis now, when you look at the merits of this policy when it was announced to Nigerians, and then you now put it side by side the lamentations and the sufferings that have trailed the implementation, how would you rate the policy generally?
Well, I don't think the policy achieved much. You know, we are told that because of the policy, kidnapping has reduced. You know, that needs to be verified, because now that criminals can access POS machine, you know, if you have your ATM card or if you have your whatsoever, they can say, okay, you must. But that they claim that has reduced. They claim that there was no money available for politicians to use, you know, in buying votes. Even that can be debated, you understand. But generally, this suffering that Nigerians have been passing through all this while is not really worth it, because the politicians that you said shouldn't have access to cash, they have access to cash. Many of these politicians don't even go to the ATM machine to withdraw money. Many of them don't enter into the banking hall. They just call their bankers and say, look, we need this amount, and they get the amount. I think that was even the confusion when the new naira notes were issued. They said, look, we issued is it 400 billion. Now it has disappeared. How did it disappear? Of course, we know. Because the people who work in the bank, they are answerable to important influential Nigerians. You know, if I have 10 billion naira in the bank, for instance, and I call the bank manager, please, out of this 10 billion naira, send 2 million.
All right.
You do something.
Are you optimistic that we are going to see the availability of this cash country, regardless of all the statements?
That actually depends on the CBN. If the CBN has not destroyed the naira note they confiscated, then there's hope. Because usually when you say, the notes are no longer legal tender, the next thing we expect is that they will take it to some place and burnt or destroyed. If CBN has not destroyed those naira notes, then they have to return them to the banks, so that banks can begin to dispense. That is number one. Secondly, because people don't have much confidence in the system. Anybody who has the new naira notes now may not return it to the bank. If you have the naira, just keep in your house, use it for transaction and try and get more. And that affects the circulation of the currency. Because people have lost, say if I take this money to the bank, I deposit it in the bank now, I'm not going to get it back.
Mm.
So it's an issue. So you see people keeping the money in their homes, or I mean using it, I mean give $500 to your children, 1,000 to buy this, and you just keep the money. Because you know if you take this money to the bank, it will not come. It's an issue that would come up. And then you see, we tend to forget that even before the redesign policy was implemented, people had issues even getting cash from ATM machines. At times you go to an ATM machine, I mean, the one I patronize regularly, at times you go there, none of the machines will be dispensing cash. Then you find a long queue, you know, because you cannot endure the long queue, begin to look for POS machines so that you can buy your money. Now, that is to tell us that, you know, we may face a situation that will be similar to what we used to experience before the CBN mopped up this currency. Because if the ATM machines are not well stocked, you know, if we don't bring out enough cash to feed the machines, then I don't think this year will be as good as we expected.
Other people are saying that, why don't we have other denominations? I mean, we are the whole policy affects only the 200, 500, and 1,000 naira. Mm. We have 100 naira and 50 naira. Why can't we have those ones, you know, enough in circulation? Perhaps it could help to cushion the effect.
Mm. Well, it's true. I mean, if we had the 100 naira note, 200 naira note, 50 naira note, because in many societies, even you don't see the higher denominations in circulation. You see cents. You see cents, you see dollars, not, I mean, $1, $2, 1 euro, 2 euro, 5 euro, you see them in circulation. But the problem we have in Nigeria is that the inflation is so high that these lower denominations, you know, I mean, they don't really buy much. If you have 15 naira and give to your son, you just look at it and say, Daddy, 15 naira. You just say, if you say, I don't have any other money. So you'll be asking him, what do I buy with the 15 naira note? Uh-huh. So, but like you said, if, for instance, the CBN, you know, did not issue the 500 or 1,000 naira note, but we have enough of 100 naira notes, you will have enough of 100 naira notes in circulation. I mean, it will fill in the gap, you know, because the important thing is to have the cash. And right. You see, the Nigerians are even used to this cashless system. It's just that you need money. You know, to be able to buy granite, you'll be able to buy, a loaf of bread from the, because the informal economy,
transportation. And you talked about Nigerians being used to the cashless policy, but this issue, this problem that happened in the past 2 months brought to the fore the problem with the cashless policy, that our banks are not even prepared. They don't have the capacity to handle it.
They don't have the capacity, the bandwidth that they are using, the infrastructure. You know, to effectively manage a cashless economy, they definitely don't have. You know, because you want to send. Okay, I give you an example. I sent 15,000 naira to my son. He said that I didn't get the money. I said I didn't get it. Yes, okay. Then I sent another 10,000 using another bank. Okay, I've got the 10,000. So he traveled from school and came back to Abuja. Then he received an alert of 15,000 naira. Then he called me and said, Daddy, you sent money to me. I said, but when you were at school, I sent 15,000. I said, did not see. That is the money. That took almost 24 hours for that money to enter into his account. And that had been debited. So, you see, the infrastructure is not there.
And in some instances, you don't get the money back.
You don't get it back.
This is a situation where it's to your son. There are instances where it's to some other persons who you don't know. And, you know, they may be credited. Later, they may not be credited. All sorts of things happened, and
so the infrastructure is not there. And then you see, apart from infrastructure, even the literacy level. You see, if you go to rural areas, you know, you see how they are ripped off. They are ripped off real time in rural areas, because if you need cash, you know, if you have your ATM machine, give it to them. They say, well, mommy. You want how much? 2,000 naira. Okay, so we are collecting 400 naira for your 2,000 naira. You must say, okay, just give me. There's nothing I can do. You understand? You say, okay, let them use USSD code. How many of them are literate enough to use USSD code? You know, you say, okay, the internet penetration in the rural areas is very, very weak. Like if I enter my village, I have to look for a network. I'll go to under one palm tree, it's not there. I'll go to under the mango tree, it's not there. Then I'll start praying. Hello, let this thing come. For me to call Abuja and say I've arrived. So right. You can't have that kind of infrastructure is not reliable. I see you are doing a cashless system. So if we are going to be cashless does not mean that you don't use cash at all. Because I've been to cashless societies and I use cash. You know, even in New York, I use cash to buy.
Maybe not in large quantity, but
not in large, but I use cash to take tea. You know, I went to a cafe and I want to take tea. I had to pay with cash, even though there is an option of using a POS machine. So that does not mean that you remove all the cash from circulation and then ask people to start using their ATM.
All right.
It doesn't work.
All right. Thank you so much, Dr. Theophilus Abah, Director of Daily Trust Foundation, for joining us on Daybreak and sharing your insights with us on these stories.
Thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you.